My name is Dawn George, and I have the privilege and the honor of being the executive director of the Macula Vision Research Foundation. Just to give you a sense of the next hour and a half or so, what the main reason that we present these patient education programs that are focused on macular degeneration is because we understand at MVRF that there's not a lot of information out there. And the information out there can be confusing. It might not be accurate. You know, that big thing now about fake news, you know? Well, and we know that that you want and need this information, you and your families, so that you can learn different ways to cope with the disease, understand better what the treatments are out there, and also understand better what the research looks like. So that's why we do this. And these are at no cost, and they're sponsored and underwritten by our sponsors. So we do these all over the country. So we're really happy to be here. Your Medford Leas is in our backyard. We're located right outside of Philadelphia, is where our headquarters are. So you're a neighbor. Secondly, we do this because we want to make it interactive. I know for a fact that every one of you in this audience today probably has a question or two that you haven't had a chance to ask your retina specialist or your ophthalmologist. Or maybe you read something and you want to know if it's accurate or if you should take certain vitamins and things like that. So we structure the format of this presentation so that it is interactive. We've got experts here today who can answer your questions, and we will have a question and answer session after the doctor presents, and then also you can speak with folks one-on-one after. We also bring tools and technology to your doorstep. Chuck Cohen from C-Tech is in the back of the room. Many of you may have seen him as you came in. Chuck has products. This is not to get you to buy something. This is not an arm twist or hard sell here. We just feel like it's important to bring things to you so you can touch them, feel them, try them. I mean, these aren't things that you go out and buy at Target. These are tools to help you with your low vision and help you to live a more independent and, quite frankly, happier life. So that's why Chuck is here, and our friends at VFO, he works with them. So he'll be here throughout, and please take a look at the back of the room when things are finished today. The other thing I always, before we get on with the program, that I like to say is that we hope that you walk away from today and head to your lunch or your appointments or wherever you're going, and you learned one or two things that you didn't know before you walked in the room. So that's what we hope happens, and I'm pretty sure it will, but that's the outcome and the goal. And lastly, we have a favor to ask you. So when you leave here today, will you do us a favor and tell everyone you know about us? Does that sound like a deal? Because word of mouth is very powerful, and macular degeneration affects 1 in 5 people. So there are 15 million Americans out there who are in the same boat as you are, or similar situation, and that number is only getting bigger. So that's what we're here for, is to find a cure, support the research so that there are new treatments and medications and things out there that will ultimately help all of you and future generations to come. So that's what we're about. So if you tell everybody you know about us, that really helps to get the job done. All right, I'm gonna stop talking because I'm just the facilitator today. Although I am passionate about this topic and what we do and how we help people. But I'm going to let a video, we're going to play a video that's going to tell you a little bit about our story, and then we're going to have Dr. Brilliant come up. Okay?
Macular degeneration is slowly robbing the sight of 15 million Americans. By the year 2020, this number is expected to be more than 20 million people. But we see a clearer future. We know a cure is on the horizon. Over the past 20 years, MVRF has given more than $21 million to the top scientists conducting the most credible and promising research around the world. For decades, macular degeneration was a mystery, something that happened to people as a part of aging. Now, because of MVRF-funded research, scientists know the nature of AMD. They are pioneering leading-edge genetic discoveries, plumbing the very depths of this devastating disease. Our work is fueling even more discoveries. Through gene therapy, we are now reversing childhood blindness and continue to make headway in advanced treatment methods for wet and dry AMD. We see macular degeneration going the way of polio and smallpox, a relic of the past, a footnote of history. We believe we're closing in. We're working every day so millions of people can keep their precious vision. It's the reason our founders, the Lotman family, started MVRF, where 100% of every dollar donated goes directly to research in the field. That's a vision we can get used to. That's a world we can believe in, because believing is seeing. MVRF is a 501c3 public charity, and we rely on support from believers like you. Thank you.
We just hit the $22 million mark. So you're the first ones to know that. Great news. First on deck in terms of our presentations this morning is a good friend of Macula Vision Research Foundation and someone that we work in partnership with on a regular basis. Some of you may recognize Dr. Richard Brilliant is with us today. He's recognized as one of the world's finest low vision specialists, and I can add to that. I agree with that. He lives right here in New Jersey, so he's a treasure for New Jersey and the area. He's an avid innovator. He's designed and developed hundreds of the best low vision devices. For nearly 40 years now, I used to say 30, but he told me today I should say 40. Dr. Brilliant has been involved in clinical investigations for low vision manufacturers. In addition to lecturing throughout the world, he has published countless articles and authored a popular optometry textbook. And I happen to have had the privilege of working with some of his students. They do some of these presentations with us, and we love to have them because it gives them good practice and experience, and they are stellar. So he's a great educator. I can vouch for that as well. Dr. Brilliant is the only optometrist on the board of the FDA, the Federal Drug Administration. So I'd like to ask Dr. Brilliant to come up. He's going to talk today about macular disease and cover a lot of the clinical and low vision areas. He's got a presentation. Thank you.
Thank you very, very much, Dawn. It's very, very nice of you. Good morning, everybody. Could everybody hear me? Yeah. As a matter of fact, I only live about 15 minutes from here, and I've passed Medford Leas a million times, and I've never realized how big it is. It's a really amazing place, so I can appreciate everybody being here, and I hope we're able to answer some of your questions. May I ask how many people here have macular degeneration? Number. How many of you have dry type of macular degeneration? How many of you have the wet type of macular degeneration? How many people have both the wet and the dry? Do you know the difference between the two? Anybody? Anybody who doesn't know, if you could raise your hand? Okay. Well, hopefully by the end of today, you'll know the difference and we'll explain why one is called wet and one is called dry. What I'd like to do is, unfortunately for some of you who have vision problems, and I see it's the majority of you, I do have a slide presentation. So I'll try to explain what's up here as well, besides just speaking about these things. What I'm starting off with is just the term macular disease. And macular disease is a term that's used in ophthalmology and optometry for those individuals who have involvement of the macula area. Does everybody know what the macula area is on the retina? Okay. Well, that's where we have to really start, because that's where you get macular degeneration from. So on the retina itself, which is the screen, the back of the eye, there's a very, very small little area called the macula. That macula is responsible for 20/20 vision or detail vision. It's also responsible for color vision. So for all those individuals who have some sort of macular disease or macular degeneration, as your vision decreases a little bit because the cells in that area are not surviving, the color vision also is affected. So people wonder why their color vision is not as good as it was before. And again, those cells in the macular area are responsible for detail vision and color vision. There's basically two different cells that are found on the retina, major cells. They are called the rods and the cones. The cones are predominantly found in the macular area. So the cones are generally responsible for the detail vision and the color vision. The rods are found more in the periphery of the retina. They're responsible for nighttime vision and motion detection. So with macular degeneration, the cells that are really affected are the cones for the most part. As you leave the macular area, you start having a buildup of the rods. So all those individuals who have macular degeneration, you must have been told by your doctors that as this condition progresses, don't worry, you're not going to go blind. And the reason they say that is because the rods are generally not affected. And so, as I said, the rods are in the periphery of the retina, and the rods will allow you to walk around without bumping into things, will allow you to see motion. As people come walking by, you'll see that. They'll allow you to see in the nighttime as well, for the most part. So those are generally not affected by this macular degeneration. Is that pretty clear? Okay. So what I wanted to do is just describe the macular disease itself, which is a degenerative condition. It's a progressive condition for the most part. Again, it does stop at a certain point for the most of the time. It's caused by many factors, okay? Within this area of macular disease is macular degeneration. Macular degeneration is generally age-related. It's generally those individuals. It might start at about age 50 or so, but you generally don't notice it until you're in your 60s or a little later. That's when it really starts to show up. It doesn't happen overnight. It's a condition that's been occurring over a period of time. You just didn't realize it. So it affects generally both eyes, and it progresses to a certain point. As I said, there are two different types with age-related macular degeneration. That's the wet type, or the atrophic or geographic. The dry type is called the dry type or geographic or atrophic macular degeneration. The wet type is called exudative macular degeneration. All right, there's also other conditions of macular degeneration which most people don't talk about because it's not as well known as age-related. And the more common ones are called Best's macular degeneration and Stargardt's macular degeneration. Now, with age-related macular degeneration, as I said, it starts at a later age. With Best's, it starts at a very, very young age, 4, 5, 6 years old. So people of that age have a similar condition as age-related macular degeneration. There's also a condition called Stargardt's, which is a macular degeneration that occurs in the teenage years. So these individuals are living with this type of macular degeneration for many, many, many more years than age-related macular degeneration, okay? But they're similar conditions. Basically, what happens with any form of macular degeneration, no matter what age you get it, is the fact that it causes this sort of blind spot in the center. It's called a scotoma. This scotoma prevents you from seeing the detail. So as I said before, your peripheral vision is still good, so you're seeing a lot of things on the side, but when you look directly at something, you're not seeing that as clearly. And I'm sure, although I don't have macular degeneration, I've certainly seen enough patients that describe this to me, and I learned a lot from my patients, more so than I've learned from my professors or from books or literature that I read, because you're living it. You know what you're going through. You're able to tell me that, and this is the way I learn a lot more, just by listening to what you have to say. But individuals, from what I understand with macular degeneration, could look at an individual, see the person's head is there, but they can't see the detail. They can't see the nose, the eyes, what makes up that individual. And that's the frustrating part of macular degeneration. So what I have here is a number of pictures that shows what it's like to have so-called normal vision, and those that they try to simulate what macular degeneration would look like with parts of the picture that they're looking at missing. As far as macular degeneration itself is concerned, there are a number of risk factors. And what I have here is a list of some of the factors that we do know cause age-related macular degeneration. Certainly, age is number one. As I said before, generally with age-related macular degeneration, it might be starting in the 50s or so. You might not notice it until your 60s or 70s, but it has progressed to that point. Usually what happens, it starts in one eye and then progresses to the other eye. They're generally not symmetrical, so one eye might be worse than the other. It's not unusual for a person who might have had the right eye being better than the left. After a number of years, the left now becomes better than the right. Again, that's part of this aging process with macular degeneration. So age is a major factor. We now know exposure to sunlight over the years causes macular degeneration as well. The ultraviolet light of the sun causes cataracts, and macular degeneration is part of that process. Race is an important factor. Age-related macular degeneration affects more of the white population than the black population. And we think the reason is that the black population obviously has more pigment, and more pigment protects their eyes from the sunlight. So therefore, the white population is going to have macular degeneration more often than the black population. And along those lines, if you're fair-skinned with blue eyes, you have less pigment, and again, they're more prone to age-related macular degeneration than a person with darker eyes, perhaps, and more pigment. Smoking. If you've smoked over the years, besides all the other problems it causes, we do know that a person who smoked for many, many years doubles the chance of getting macular degeneration. So smoking is a major factor. Family history, of course. Those individuals who've had age-related macular degeneration in the family might have a greater chance of getting macular degeneration itself. Now, I know there's a lot of patients that come to me and say, well, I have age-related macular degeneration. What's the chances of my children getting it? There's really no way to answer that other than the fact that they do have a higher risk than those individuals who have parents who don't have age-related macular degeneration. But I've certainly seen where there's twins that come to me, and they're identical twins, and one has it and the other one doesn't. So I really can't account for why, when you say it's in the family, that why a twin who's identical, one would have it and one not. So it's really sort of a crapshoot at this point. Again, I don't think, no matter how much research has gone into things, into this area of macular degeneration, that we could say explicitly that you're going to get macular degeneration and you're not. We've just haven't come that far yet. But again, if it's in the family, there's a greater chance of family members having it. There are other minor things that come up as far as the chances of having macular degeneration. And this is not to scare you or anybody else. But people who are farsighted, hyperopia, tend to have a little greater chance of getting macular degeneration, we're finding, than those who are myopic or nearsighted. Again, the reason is we're not sure. And we're not sure if this is even a major factor, but it has appeared in some of the research that's come out recently on macular degeneration, that those individuals who have macular degeneration tend to be a little bit more farsighted. Also, there's a thing called the cup to disc ratio. Now, this is something that's a lot more, I guess, sophisticated than we have to talk about here today. But within the retina, within the macula, within the back of the eye, the retinal area, there's the optic nerve. Now, this is just an aside. We do know that the eye really doesn't see. The eye just collects information and sends it back to the brain, and they're really the brain that sees. So the way it's transmitted back to the brain is through the optic nerve. It's a cable. Within the optic nerve, there's a we call the optic nerve head a disc. Within that disc, there's a sort of saucer or cup. If we measure that cup to the size of the disc, we find that those individuals who have a large cup to disc ratio have less chance of getting macular degeneration. Again, we're not sure of why this occurs. We do know that with the condition of glaucoma, that there's generally a large cup to disc ratio. So we don't know if it's the pressure inside the eye that's preventing the macular degeneration or not, but that's a factor that has to be looked at as well. Okay? We also know that those individuals who have vascular problems, high blood pressure, cholesterol, diabetes, have a greater tendency to get age-related macular degeneration. So again, we think the reason for that is the macula itself is getting less nourishment, less oxygen, because of these disease processes, and therefore they're more prone to age-related macular degeneration. We do know that diet and obesity are a major factor as well with macular degeneration. Those people who tend to be overweight have a greater chance of having macular degeneration. And the reason being is the adipose tissue, that the fatty tissue tends to hold a lot of nutrients within that tissue, and therefore less chance of it getting to the macular area. So again, these are all factors. Some other things we know about macular degeneration as well is the fact that those individuals who eat a lot of red meat on a daily basis have a higher incidence of getting age-related macular degeneration. So the recommendation for those individuals who are more prone to age-related macular degeneration, where it's in the family, is to eat more fish, generally fish more than two or three times a week, to have a lot of green leafy vegetables. Again, we know that they carry a lot of carotenoids, which are important for the nourishment of the macular area. And so we recommend those individuals who are concerned about their macular degeneration or getting it, if they have a dry type, we recommend they certainly eat a lot more fish with green leafy vegetables and less meat. What are the signs and symptoms of macular degeneration? And again, I guess you could tell that to me better than I could tell you, but I'll just go through the list of the things that I know. We do know that you get reduced visual acuity at distance and near, okay? We do know that that visual acuity can fluctuate from day to day. Now again, this is not written in any of the literature. I've never learned this in a textbook or from a professor, but certainly seeing enough patients, I could tell you that there are a lot of individuals with macular degeneration who tell me on certain days they see better than other days. Or on a given day they could wake up and their vision might be good or bad, and later on in that day it's again just the opposite, good or bad. And again, there's probably reasons for it. Besides being tired, maybe at the end of the day why it might be a little worse. If you have a cold or you're not feeling well, generally the vision is a little worse. If it's cloudy, very uncomfortable day, your vision is not very good. On a sunny, bright day, you generally feel a little bit better, your vision is a little bit better. Is there anybody that experiences this here in the audience? Is it similar to what I'm saying? Yeah. I mean, but again, I've tried looking through the literature to see if I could find out reasons for it, and And I've talked to retinal surgeons and all, and they really don't have answers at this point. But again, there's been enough patients that report that, so I think that's pretty significant. So that's called fluctuation in vision, when a person has that, where the vision might vary from day to day or hour to hour. Those individuals who have age-related macular degeneration, whether it be wet or dry, have a central blind spot. As I said, it's called a scotoma. That's a blind spot. So if you ever heard your doctor say, well, you have this scotoma, or if they're mentioning it to maybe their interns or residents, that's all they're saying is you have a blind spot in the center, which is related to the fact that the cells in that macular area are not functioning as well anymore, and it leaves this blind spot. There's also a condition called metamorphopsia, where you get a distortion in that central area. If anybody has looked at an AMSLA grid, are you familiar with an AMSLA grid? Okay, excellent. So Dawn mentioned everybody's going to be able to get an AMSLA grid. I'm sure many of your doctors might have given you an AMSLA grid to view. What you're doing is you're looking at a grid, lines that go across vertically and horizontally, and you want to see if any of those lines are missing or if they're distorted. If they're distorted, that is the term metamorphopsia, and generally goes along with the idea of this blind spot or scotoma or some edema, some swelling in the macular area, which causes this metamorphopsia or distortion. Similar to, like, if you think about it, on a really hot summer day, sometimes the road itself sort of buckles a little bit and you get that distortion. So when you're driving in a car, you notice these bumps. That's what swelling does in the macular area. It causes a distortion or metamorphopsia because the swelling causes a bump in the macular area. So that's fairly common, again, with macular degeneration. You're going to get reduced contrast. And this is one of my favorite topics, because I have a lot of patients that come in to see me and they'll say to me, you know, I just saw my retinal doctor and he says everything is all right, but I'm telling the retinal doctor my vision is not the same as it was before. I'm not seeing as well as I did before. And I'm telling you that. And I take your vision and your vision is exactly the same as it was when I last saw you. And so the doctor, whether it be me or any other doc that you see, is going to say, well, the good news is your vision is exactly the same. It's just you're thinking too much about your vision, you're worried about your vision, and that's why you think your vision is decreased. Well, that just ain't so. What happens is when you're looking at a visual acuity chart, it's the blackest print against the whitest background. That's 100% contrast. So people do better with 100% contrast. Unfortunately, the real world doesn't exist that way. The real world exists in shades of gray. So when you're looking at something, whether it be the TV or a book or whatever, you're noticing you're not seeing that as clearly or as easily as you were before. It's because your contrast has decreased. Now, we don't measure generally contrast. There are ways of doing it, but in most practices, we don't do it. We do know that contrast decreases as we get older. So even when you have perfect vision, your contrast is going to get worse. We do know that when you have conditions that affect the macular area, such as macular degeneration, your contrast is being affected. So your contrast is going to decrease. So what do I mean by that in the real world? When you look at a TV and the TV doesn't look as sharp, it's your contrast generally, not your visual acuity. When you're looking at a curb that sort of blends in with the street, and a lot of people with macular degeneration have problems seeing where the street ends and the curb begins, that's a decrease in your contrast. If you're looking at steps or stairs that are not brightly lit and you can't really tell the depth of the step or how many steps there are, that's a reduction in your contrast. So you think your vision is getting worse. It's not your visual acuity. It's your contrast sensitivity that's decreasing. So the question is that now that we know this, what do you do about it? Well, many years ago, we said we couldn't do anything about it, and that's why we didn't measure it. We do know now that you can improve contrast to some extent, and we do that in a low vision evaluation. If a person has reduced contrast, which I'm sure all of you do, and I have perfect vision, my contrast is decreased as well. You could increase contrast by better illumination, better lighting. You could increase contrast by magnification. And you could increase contrast by certain filters. That's why sometimes people will say, where I wear a yellow filter, a yellow lens, it makes it a little sharper, a little clearer. It's because it's improving your contrast. If a person says, I'm able to read a little bit better when you bring the light over to what I'm reading, that's improving your contrast. So these three factors will improve contrast. And again, just to let you know that when you think your visual acuity is getting worse and you've gone to the doctor and the doctor says, the good news is everything looks good, your vision is the same, and you leave wondering, well, why is he saying that or she's saying that when I know my vision's not as good? It's because the contrast is decreased. Okay, and we know how we could fix that to some extent. Okay? So we do get a reduction in contrast with macular degeneration. We also get a reduction in depth perception with macular degeneration. And again, because of the contrast, that affects the depth perception, but also because there's a difference between the two eyes. Generally, the visual acuity is worse in one eye than the other. And when you have two eyes that are not working properly and equal to each other, you're going to lose your depth perception. Okay? So again, it's not unusual for somebody to say that I'm not seeing how deep that stairwell is, or I'm having problems seeing the depth of the curb. Again, because the difference between two eyes in visual acuity, as well as the loss in contrast. As I said before, the macular area is responsible for color vision. So most of us who have macular degeneration are going to start losing some of your color perception. Things are not going to look as colorful or as sharp as they did before. You're going to increase the need for a lighting, again, because that improves contrast and improves visual acuity. You're going to be bothered by glare and what we call photophobia, meaning bothered by bright lights outside or bright lights indoors. The sunlight bothers you more than the average individual. Well, again, I'm trying to figure out why that happens. And again, it's not in the literature. But I think I finally figured it out. What happens is the cells inside the eye, the cones and the rods, when they're not functioning as well as they did when they were so-called normal, when light enters the eye, the light is absorbed by those cells. When those cells are not working properly, then their light, sunlight is reflected off of those cells. And therefore, you get this glare on your retina. And that's why you tend to be more bothered by glare and bright sunlight. So again, to me, that seems very, very logical. And I'm almost sure that I'm right in what I'm saying. But again, I've not been able to find this in the literature. One of the other things that it seems to occur with macular degeneration, and it doesn't occur with every patient, but it's somewhat common now, is sometimes patients will tell the doctor that they're seeing things that they know are not there. I see some of my relatives that I know are not there anymore. I see a pink elephant, and it's always in the same place, and I see it whether my eyes are open or whether my eyes are closed. Well, at one time, the doctor would send the patient to a psychiatrist or psychologist because they would say, you're hallucinating. You worried so much about your vision, you're thinking these things up, and we have to have you see a psychiatrist or a psychologist. We now know that probably 99.9% of all those individuals that are experiencing this problem are suffering from a condition called Charles-Bonnet syndrome. Charles-Bonnet syndrome is where an individual with a visual problem, generally a macular problem, but not all the time, but the majority of the time, macular problem, where they tend to see things, usually in dark environments, and they know they're not real, but they can explain to the doctor or an individual they're talking to and depict that image as clearly as ever. Okay? Again, it's a safe condition. It doesn't mean your eyes are deteriorating. It's basically your brain playing tricks on your eye. Okay? So Charles-Bonnet syndrome was first reported in 1760 by a Swiss individual who noticed his grandfather complaining about these conditions. His grandfather had cataracts, which again is the outside part of the eye, not the inside part of the eye. But this Charles Bonnet syndrome, as I said, affects the majority of patients when they have macular problems. There has been some reports of people with no visual problems sometimes experiencing this as well, but that's extremely rare. But this Charles Bonnet syndrome is a condition that occurs with these individuals with macular degeneration, generally individuals who are living alone. So socialization is extremely important. So for those individuals who are living alone and experiencing this, we do know that over a period of time that it will go away. There have been many times that doctors have prescribed medication for these individuals. Prescribed medications for these individuals, but they don't really seem to work. So really what happens is if an individual is experiencing this problem, socialization becomes a major factor. If they get along, you know, get to meet more people and spend a little bit more time with people, we know that's a factor. We also know that if they use low vision devices, believe it or not, that eliminates some of the problem. But they generally might have this problem for a year or two and then it goes away just like it came. But it's a harmless situation. For those individuals who could see this slide presentation here, I just wanted to point out this is the macula area. This is the optic nerve that I was talking to you about. And you can see this little white area is the cup. This yellow area is the disc. So the ratio between this cup to disc is what the doctor will relate to as whether it's a large cup to disc ratio or small or whatever, okay? But if you notice here, this is the retina, the back of the eye. Coming out of the optic nerve are the blood vessels. And the blood vessels sort of go around the retina, but they never cross the macula area. And the reason being is the macula area, as I said, is the area that's responsible for detail vision. So if you think about it, if the blood vessels cross the macula area, you would see the blood vessels. It's like looking out a window. If there's no trees in front, you're able to get a clear view. If you have tree branches in front of that window, the tree branches are going to affect your view. So with macular degeneration, there's no blood vessels that cross, or with the macula itself, there's no blood vessels that cross the macula. The macula is fed by a different blood supply than the retinal blood vessels that you see in the retinal area. All right. The other thing I wanted to mention, which has nothing to do with macular degeneration, this is the only part of the body where a doctor could look inside the eye and see diabetes, high blood pressure, and conditions like that without cutting somebody open. So when a doctor looks inside your eye, he or she is looking at the blood vessels and determining whether that person might have macular degeneration, high blood pressure, cholesterol problems, diabetes, or whatever. And that's, again, by the blood vessels that we see on this picture here. Again, just to show you, these are additional pictures of macular degeneration to show you all the different appearances that macular degeneration might show. So it's not one particular appearance that macular degeneration has. Again, you might have heard, the doctor might have mentioned to you drusens. There are soft drusens and hard drusens. We do know that hard drusens, they're little white specks inside the macular area, are more prone to show macular degeneration. So those individuals who have drusens, hard drusens in the macular area, if you don't have macular degeneration at this point, the doctor might say you're more prone to macular degeneration in the future. Okay? And drusens are nothing more than little vacuoles that contain the garbage inside the eye. As the cells are producing and going through metabolic changes, they have to get rid of some of their junk. And so that's what drusens are. Thank you, Dawn. Yeah. What I wanted to show here, there's a picture of age-related macular degeneration as it compares to Stargardt's. Stargardt's, as I said, was a form of macular degeneration but occurs in teenagers. There is a slight difference in the appearance, and for those that people could see that, you might be able to detect the difference in the drusens that are age-related macular degeneration, and what appears to be drusens here are not drusens. They're called musci volantates. Fundus flavia maculatus. It's another form that are associated with Stargardt's. It's a drusen-like material, but it's not actually drusens. All right, so again, just to sum up some of this with age-related macular degeneration, with the dry or atrophic type, the visual acuity will vary from 20/25 acuity, probably all the way up to about 20/400, and hopefully not get any worse than that. With the wet type might be a point where it even gets worse than 20/400. Although now with the injections that people are getting for the wet type, it does seem to be slowing the process down. It doesn't improve the visual acuity, but it does slow the process down, okay? And it prevents it from worse. All right, just to sort of summarize, because I know I'm running out of time. The two different types are treated differently. The dry type, the only thing that we could do really right now is recommend diet, exercise, and a medication called PreserVision, okay, which is a multivitamin, basically, that you take on a daily basis. And that has proven to slow the process down of age-related macular degeneration dry type. The wet type, the best thing for the wet type right now appears to be these injections. And as I said, a lot of my patients think when they go in there, they're going to get these injections and their vision is going to be restored. It doesn't restore your vision. It prevents it from getting worse. There are a few patients that will come out after the injections and report that their visual acuity has improved a little bit, one or two lines better, which is good, and that has occurred, but it does not restore your vision back to where it was in so-called normal times.
He's not going away. We're going to use this part as the question and answer for the Ask the Doc. Okay, and Nikki and Lynn from the MVRF team are going to run around here and give you the microphone so everyone can hear your question. And are you coming this way, ladies? We got some hands up already. Okay, we've got one here in the front row. What's your name?
Joan
has a question. Here comes Nikki.
What makes dry turn into wet?
Nikki can give you the mic. Is that or this one? Yeah. Okay.
The wet type of macular degeneration is basically characterized by two factors. One is a growth of blood vessels into the macular area, which is a no-no. You don't want blood vessels in the macular area, as I mentioned before. Or there's a fluid leakage. So the doctor will do what they call fluorescein angiography, where they inject a dye into your arm, and they're able to take pictures and see what's occurring inside the eye. And when you look inside the eye and you see some leakage of fluid, or you see these blood vessels, then that's now diagnosed as wet macular degeneration. Dry would not have that. Dry would not have blood. Yeah, we do know that with dry macular degeneration, in many of the cases, over a period of time, it gets worse. And when it gets worse, you get this blood vessel growth or leakage of the blood vessels. The blood vessels are weakened at that point, and so they leak some fluid. There's nothing that you could do other than, as I said, watch your diet, do exercise, and take the ARID study medication, the PreserVision pills. That's the only thing. And if it does occur, you get the injections, and when you get the injections, you get enough injections over a period of time where hopefully it goes back to the dry type. Yes, yes. So that's the whole idea behind the injections. When the doctor brings you back every 4 to 6 weeks to see what's going on, he or she is observing any fluid leakage or blood vessel growth from last time. And it gets to a certain point, hopefully, where it stops and everything dries up, and then you're going back to the dry type. So, I'm sorry? Oh, yeah, yeah. That's the whole idea behind the injections.
Okay, I think this woman had a question.
No, that was really my question. How long do you go having the injections before the doctor says, I don't need to see you again? Because my doctor told me this week that this was going to be continuous.
Yeah.
So what does he mean?
Well, it can mean two things. It can mean one is that you're going to keep on coming back for injections, or it could mean you keep on coming back and I'm just going to continue to observe and it seems to be stabilized, but I just want to make sure it doesn't get in. You go back to the wet type again. So it could be good. You know, for the most part, it's good.
Okay, so I understand that the injections don't restore the vision, but they can stop the progression or maybe change wet to dry. So at what point, I don't have macular yet, but I have a huge family history. So at what point do you recommend starting injections? I mean, if you have the wet.
Oh, you can't get the injections unless you show the fluid leakage. So usually what happens, the scenario generally is if you're being observed by either an ophthalmologist or an optometrist that is not a retinal specialist, they will have you probably come back every 6 months. Unless you note a change in your vision, then you come back sooner, of course. But if there's no noted change, you'll come back every 6 months, you'll be dilated, the doctor will look inside the eye to see if there's any changes going on. If there's a visual acuity loss, or any thing that seems a little unusual for the doctor, he then will refer that, or she will refer that patient to a retinal surgeon. My feeling is, if you have macular degeneration, you can still go to your regular eye doctor, but I think you should go to your retinal specialist. You should have a retinal specialist as well. I liken it to a person who has a heart problem. Even though you might have your family doctor taking care of your blood pressure and your cholesterol problem, the cardiologist knows a little bit more about the heart than the general practitioner. And so visiting the cardiologist every 6 months or once a year is probably a good situation or habit to have. I view that the same with a retinal specialist. So if you do have it in the family, or if you are more prone, you think, to having a retinal problem, I would encourage you to see a retinal specialist once a year besides your regular doctor. Not only that, but once you get used to the doctor, and if you like that doctor, then God forbid if you do get it, at least you know you're in good hands instead of being tossed to a doctor you've never met before, and all of a sudden he or she is injecting you with a needle in your eye.
And don't you agree, doctor? I just want to comment on this because I've learned a lot about this myself, even though I'm not a doctor. A retina doc. But don't you agree that I think we try to tell people that macular degeneration is very individualized, right? So you may be sitting at lunch later with one of your friends here and you're talking about the presentation and you're comparing notes, but what might work for you if you've just been diagnosed with drusen or what have you, I don't know, but what might be work for you and what the person across from you might have experienced could be totally different, but you're still both getting injections. One's a little having an impact, one's not, and your doctor really has to monitor that, right? Yeah. And kind of direct that care. But those are good questions. I think we have time for two more real quick. Sure. Go ahead.
Oh, I'd like to ask a question about Charles-Bonnet syndrome. I had it, and I was wondering if I was doing something to bring it on.
Certainly, just like macular degeneration, you didn't do anything wrong. You're not to blame for this. It just happens to certain people. What happens is, in your situation, perhaps your brain just sort of took over and interpreting certain things. It's likened to phantom limb syndrome, where individuals who've had been in war or whatever have had their leg removed, and they still feel that leg is there. That's what they think exists with this Charles-Bonnet syndrome, that the brain thinks that the eye is still perfectly normal, and maybe this blind spot takes on the figure of a relative or an elephant or whatever, and the brain just interprets it as such. But you didn't do anything wrong. There's nothing you could have done to prevent it, and I'm glad to hear it went away. And as I said, it generally lasts about a year or two, and then it goes away.
It was about a month.
Yeah, sometimes it goes around, you know, got quicker.
And they're very pushy people.
Well, when they start talking to you and telling you what to do, right, you might not have Charles-Bonnet syndrome.
Yeah. I have one more question right
here.
Do
we have one more? Okay.
Yep.
I'd like to ask about the current research on preservation and taking the AREDS vitamins. I don't know what the actual result will be by taking them, but I do take them every day.
Do you have macular degeneration?
Yes.
Yeah. Are you taking the ARID-1 or the ARID-2? Two, okay. Anybody taking the ARID-1 medication? Okay. Well, we do know with the problem with the ARID-1 is if you were a smoker, if you smoked cigarettes, that actually caused a greater chance of getting lung cancer because of the vitamin A. So vitamin A was in the ARID-1 study, and they've now taken that out in the ARID-2. The only thing we know is we think that the ARIDS-2, the PreserVision medication, will prevent the condition, dry macular degeneration, from getting worse. And it showed over a period of 6 years that that was true. After 6 years, I don't know. But the research that went into it so far was for 6 years. The problem that no doctor tells you is that that medication doesn't work for everybody. We don't know who it works for and who it doesn't work for. We do know that it's not something that you take and for sure it's going to stop your macular degeneration for those 6 years. Okay? So again, it's an individual basis and it's never spoken about, but I'm telling you that we do know that it just doesn't work 100% for every single patient. So it can't hurt. There's the only thing I could tell you, if you have a heart problem, you got to be careful with that, because vitamin E, you can't take more than 400 units of vitamin E. And if you're taking that and a multivitamin at the same time, you're getting more than 400 units of vitamin E on a daily basis. So you should talk to your cardiologist about that. Okay? We do also know that the lutein and xanthanine, which is now part of the ARIDS-2 medication, had really not proven to slow the process down. But we do know with macular degeneration that those two minerals are reduced with macular degeneration. So that's why the thinking is if you take that, that you're going to get more into your macular area and hopefully slow it down. But the research that ended up proving the ARIDS-2 being a better medication showed that the xanthanine and lutein really didn't do much. But the thinking was it's better than vitamin A, and that there might be some reason for using that. So it doesn't hurt to take that.
So that's great. I want to make one comment about that. We also, along with Dr. Brilliant and other clinicians that we work with, recommend, because PreserVision is over the counter, okay, and it can't hurt your overall health. You should always, as Dr. Brilliant said, tell your other doctors that you're taking it, because it is a supplement. But lutein, you're born with a certain amount of lutein, and that's all you have for the rest of your life. So the way you get lutein is through your diet, and also in this case the supplements, right? So lutein is important in that way. So I know others have questions, but we want to get on to our next presenter. Let's give a hand to Dr. Brilliant. He's brilliant, isn't he? And also he will be available for one-on-one questions after the session. Okay, so I know we've got a few kind of hands up, so he'll be here to ask talk with you directly. Oh, there we go. Well, that's a good segue to presenting the, sorry about that. The next individual I want to bring up here who will round out our program, I'm losing my paper here. Here we go, is a very dear friend of Macula Vision Research Foundation, and his name is Charlie Collins. And Charlie is with VFO, who's the company who makes the wonderful products in the back of the room. It was a recent merger with Optilec and Freedom Scientific. He's the director of sales for the Eastern United States for them. He's also the original founder and former CEO of Vision Dynamics, recently sold the company. He and also has Charlie Collins International. He is a certified professional success coach and a well-respected motivational, inspirational speaker. He travels all over the world and speaks to groups, so we're pretty lucky to have him today. He helps empower and inspire people to live life with a clear vision, and he knows firsthand how important that is and what tools are out there. And lastly, he's got all this these kudos here. Charlie is best-selling author, actually, of this book right here, Tripping Into the Light. We do have copies if you care to purchase one today. But he does a lot. You can tell he's a busy guy, and we're, lucky to have him here today. And so let's give Charlie a round of applause.
Got it. Collins. C-O-L-L-I-N-S. Like Tom Collins, who happens to be my cousin. Well, thank you, Dawn. When I was in third grade, I was pulled out of the classroom, and back in those days, a school nurse used to come and check on the students, and I was out in the hallway, and they had a few tests they were doing, but one of them was an eye test, and they had a chart, and they used to ask us to look down the chart, and they would check off some boxes. But when it got down lower on the chart, I couldn't see the bottom, and I remember the nurse saying to me, "Well, just tell me what it says." Well, I would if I could. So they didn't really believe that I couldn't, because there was nothing wrong with me. So I went back into class. But for the next 2 years, I had an older brother and a sister that also had some struggles in school. And it happened to do with reading, seeing the chalkboard. And so my mother and my parents took us to different types of eye doctors. We went to psychiatrists. I'm just enjoying the saw. And we went to kind of learning challenge, like dyslexia. We're trying to figure out what was going on. Why were we struggling? The words were moving around or not appearing right on the page and on the chalkboard. Well, after 2 years of that, we were in a doctor's office, and the doctor suggested that we head up to Mass Eye and Ear in Boston. He said, "I think there's something. I think it has to do with the eyes." And so we jumped in our big old green Plymouth station wagon, the one with the wood paneling on the side. And I have four sisters and one brother. So in the hospital, they wanted us all to come, the whole family. So all eight of us were in the station wagon. We headed up to Massachusetts. Now I'm from Connecticut. Well, we went through a couple days of testing. And at the end of that, before we left, they sat us down. And I remember the doctors, there were two doctors, real grizzly guys, big beards. This was in the late 70s. And they came in and they said, "You know, we would like to let you know that four out of the six children have a very rare eye disease called juvenile macular degeneration. And I was one of them. And I guess it's called Stargardt's, maybe best." Possibly, because I had a younger sister who was four and five at that time with no visual problem, but they already knew she was going to get it. So now four out of six of us were diagnosed with this rare eye condition. But they asked us to come back. So the next quarter, we came back, and we did this for a good year and a half. The entire family kept going back up there. And I liked it because I got out of school. But it was grueling, two full days usually of testing and testing and testing. And I thought, geez, by the end of this, obviously, they're going to cure it, fix us. Well, on our final visit, we were sat down in a room, and the doctor said, you know, we really appreciate everything you've done. Really, we want to let you know there's nothing we can do. And I remember thinking, there's no pair of glasses, there's no magic pill. I'm like 10, 11 years old. I'm 11 at this time. And I'm starting to think, I can't believe we did all this, and they're doctors. They should be fixing me. Isn't that their job? Well, they handed us a piece of paper. Well, not us, my mother. And it listed all the things we shouldn't do in our life. It was, you know, don't play sports. And if you do, you know, certainly don't play badminton. But it was all the things that we were going to struggle with in our lives. And one of them said we weren't going to be able to get our driver's license. Another one said we weren't going to be able to see colors that well and things like that. Well, I do remember when we got up to leave, my mother took that piece of paper, crumpled it up, and threw it out. Because she didn't want to start this journey with her four children thinking of all the things we couldn't do. Let's focus on what we can do. I didn't. I went home, and I remember sitting in it thinking, wait a minute. You mean I might not get my driver's license someday? You mean that my eyes are going to get worse than they are now? Well, picture this, you know, you're going into school, you're 13 years old, you're walking down that hallway, and you see people coming at you, but you can't quite make out who it is. As Dr. Brilliant said, you see the movement, but the clarity, the detail's gone. I go sit into the classroom, the teacher's writing on a chalkboard. You can hear the noise. You can see some of the print up there, not that clear, and especially it seems to be not in the center of the chalkboard. Then the teacher would say, hey, let's turn to page 38 and start reading, and a big thump, lump in my upper chest, like, oh no, reading. I hate reading because I could barely do it at this time. Age 13. Off to gym class. And then this day, they line you up, all the kids, and then two of the best players usually, or whoever, the gym teacher, says, all right, pick your team, and today we're playing dodgeball. Well, I got picked last because the kids there knew I couldn't see. I'm definitely not going to be good on that team. Someone's going to throw the ball and get me out pretty quick. And It was a tough day. It was a tough day for a 13-year-old who was full of fear, who felt alone, who didn't fit in, and who really didn't talk about it either. So on I went home that day, and I walked in the house, and my mother says, hey, welcome home. How was school? And I said, it was fine. Like, I'm going to tell my mother. She said, you got a piece of mail. Big piece of mail in the other room. And I thought, oh, that's exciting. So I went in the other room, and it was this big piece of mail. And I ripped it open, and I dumped out the contents. And it fell on the table, and there was all sorts of stuff. But there was a large piece of paper. I remember pulling it up, and in large print, it said, my name, Charles J. Collins, you have been declared legally blind. Oh, thank you. That's what every 13-year-old wants to receive from a state. See, I thought I wasn't good enough. I started thinking like I was a loser because of those two doctors. They just told me, your life's not going to amount to anything. You have a disease. But now my whole state is telling me. They even sent me a certificate that I'm not going to hang. And I did earn it. You know, today, I'm definitely grateful I wasn't declared illegally blind. That could be a tough thing for us. So that was 13. You know what I did for the next 10 years? I do what a lot of people do. Not all, but what some of us do is we get the news, and then we go home and think about it. And we think about how terrible it is. And we think about, oh, I'm not going to be able to be Magnum PI. I'm not going to be able to fly jets. I'm not going to be able to be a cop. I'm never going to be able to drive. I'm not going to be able to see. Oh, that list just couldn't stop coming, the things I couldn't do. And I thought more about myself. I thought less about myself. My self-esteem went down. My relationships got tough. My grades in school plummeted. And I blamed. That finger was out. It wasn't me, it was the teacher. It wasn't me, it was my parents. It wasn't me, it was God. Those were the people that were responsible for my suffering. Had nothing to do with me. Why should I have macular degeneration? I'm 16 years old now. I can't get my driver's license. At 18, I went down a motor vehicle, and I tried to pass my motorcycle's license. I went down to go get that one, said, you know, who needs to drive a car? I want to drive a motorcycle anyway. And I failed the eye test. Go figure. But I almost got by. But I wouldn't be standing here if I had gotten a motorcycle's license. So, you know, that way, when we focus on what we can't do and what's wrong and the problem, we get more of that in life, and it makes things very difficult. So I happened to be 23 or so, and I was up at a motorcycle dealership, and I owned a motorcycle at that time of my life. I was a dirt bike, and I rode through the woods. But I was often up at the motorcycle shop getting parts for it and things. So I happened to be cutting the lawn up there every week. And the owner came out. And it was a beautiful day. It certainly wasn't cold like today, but it was a beautiful sunny day. And I remember looking at the line of motorcycles and finally kind of fell into a dream. Because you know what macular degeneration took away from me? It took away me looking forward. Like, there's going to be any reason to. And it really had me only looking behind, like, what's wrong? The past is no good. So, but I remember that day, I kind of fell into a little bit of a dream. And I got a tap on my shoulder, and I turned to look. And it was this long, bearded, ZZ Top-looking dude. And this guy's name was Jimbo. He owned the motorcycle dealership. And I thought, wow, what does Jimbo want? He said, hey, can I talk to you? And I thought he was going to fire me, no longer let me cut the lawn, because I mean, obviously, why would he want a legally blind guy cutting his lawn anyway? What is he, silly? Well, I was pretty darn good at it. He said, no, I didn't say any of that. I thought it. He said, hey, I was wondering if you would like to work here. Me, legally blind guy. I mean, what's he thinking? Why would I want to work here? And matter of fact, I would love to work here. So I said, I'll have to let you know. That's scary. I remember thinking, my gosh, I like to live in my comfort zone of suffering, not reading, failing out of college, living with my parents. Life's never going to amount to anything. Now this guy's offering me an opportunity. How could I possibly take it? I can barely read. Well, I went home and I told my mom. She said, you'd be great at that. You're blah, 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 blah. And that's what moms do. I went to bed that night, and I laid in this bed. This bed I lied in for many, many years. This bed I lied in and wished I wouldn't wake up in the morning. The same bed I'd look to the God of my misunderstanding and say, please take me tonight. I don't want to be alive anymore. Well, not this night. Something shifted. I went to bed, I slept well, I got up in the morning, I went back to the motorcycle shop, and I walked into Jimbo's office, and I told him flat out, Jim, I would love to take the job, but I'm scared. Secondly, I'm legally blind. Didn't you know? I mean, doesn't that written all over my body? Because that's all I think about. And he said, oh, I knew you had a vision impairment, but that's not why I'm hiring you. I'm hiring you because you're passionate. You believe in these motorcycles, and most of all, you're going to be an asset, and you'll add to the company and the people here. I was like, wow. He goes, I believe in you, Charlie. I know you can do this. I needed somebody to believe in me at that time of my life. But you know what I had to do at that time? I had to ask for help. Had anyone ever surrendered to something before? I surrendered to this little disease in the back of my eye that was controlling my life. I was making bad decisions because of it. I was going nowhere. Well, I released it. I said, you know what? Screw you. Excuse me. That slipped. But you know what? I'm not going to allow this little thing, drusens or all those other words you use today. to control my life anymore. I'm just going to let it go, and I need help. Oh, did I just ask for help? Yes. My gosh, me? I mean, 20, young 20-year-old guy. I don't need help. I did. You know what I got? Chuck has one on the back table. Well, it certainly wasn't as current as what Chuck had. But I got a video magnifier, an Optelect one. I could start putting the manuals, the sales sheets, and all the things in my new job on a tray, and it went up on a screen. I could see. I could read. Dr. Brilliant talked about it. It heightened contrast. It magnified. My brain lit up. See, what happens when a brain is a muscle, right? Our brain, so it goes into atrophy if we stop using it. If we stop using the reading pathways, we stop using the creative things, that goes to rest. Mine was at rest. So I slowly started reading, writing. I learned how to use a computer. I got proper lighting. I got optical magnifiers, which are the kind you carry around and use on the go. I painted the inside of the dealership. I put large print signs. Something that's critically important for each of us to do is to adapt our environment to suit our needs. Then we can go through day to day without ever thinking about having a disability. Ugh, I don't even like that word. So because of doing all that, because of taking action, you know, it's just amazing. You know, within 3 short years, I went from cutting the lawn, I became the vice president and a part owner of this company. This was a multi-million dollar serious business, and I'm now one of the owners. Like, shaking my head, pinch me. How did this happen? I barely got out of high school. I didn't make it through college because I was too afraid. It wasn't that I wasn't smart enough. It wasn't that I wasn't good enough. It was my thinking. It was me telling me I was no good because of macular. So, you know, I went on to start another company that I sold. I owned it for 19 years. I helped about 1,200 people a year regain their independence that were suffering from all types of low vision, especially macular degeneration. I got to do that for 19 years. Work with people just like you that would come in, like Chuck does. Chuck has a place and he drives all around and he helps service and helps people to improve the quality of their lives. Because you know, we're all gonna be here until we're not. Might as well take action. I did that, now I get to fly around the country. I wrote a book. This isn't about me, it's about you guys. Bottom line is, the way I look at it, is you all have a decision to make. Maybe you all have desktops and portables and magnifiers and you have all the latest gadgets and you go through the day like me, not even ever thinking of having a vision impairment. Doesn't even enter my mind. Don't think about it. I go about my life. I travel. I go to airports alone. I get on airplanes. I do all sorts of stuff. Forget, I go out and walk New York City at night. I remember I did it recently few months back, I got lost. And my phone rang. It was my wife. She's like, where are you? I go, I don't know. She goes, aren't you in New York City? Yeah, I know that. She goes, well, who are you with? I don't know any of them either. So, you know, I trust and rely on that power that's deep within all of us already. As Dr. Brilliant said, we don't see with our eyes. We see with our brains. And with a healthy brain, macular degeneration could go, I can't say it, but can go to church. Dawn and I are going to do a little exercise, all right? Are you guys, please raise your hand if you're still with me. Raise your arm, actually. All right. Dawn asked earlier, if I spoke too fast, to please raise your hand. I was going to ask you to do that, but you would have gotten a sore shoulder, so I didn't ask. All right.
Ooh.
Yeah. All right, so what I want you to do is I want you to fold your hands, like you're saying a prayer or whatever that is to you. If you can't see, can you guys see what I'm doing? All right. All right, you all got up. All right, now I want you to do that. I want you to look down, and I want you to remember which thumb is on top. Everyone look down, say, okay, I see which one it is, and then go ahead and separate your hands. All right, now everybody that had their left thumb on top, please raise your hand. All right, you guys are the better thinkers in the group. All right, now I want everybody who had their right thumb on top, please raise your hand high. You guys are the sexier ones. I'm glad to hear you're awake still and sexy. All right, so now let's do something. I want you to then pull your hands apart. I want you to put them back together, but I want you to put the other thumb on top. So shift your fingers. Oh, a couple of you struggling a little here. All right, how does that feel? Different, yucky. I hear someone up front saying, I can't do it. Well, we got a course on that. All right, so now go ahead, pull them apart and go back to the original way. How's that feel? Ah, welcome to your comfort zone. Welcome to a habit. That's all that is. I got to tell you, the research, well, I didn't say it, so I don't have to say it, but the left thumb, right thumb, that's fake. I just made that up, okay? But what I'm trying to, I want you to know is, if you're used to doing it a certain way, do you realize you can get comfortable with macular degeneration, not reading, not taking action? Actually, it'll become a habit. It's harder to break that and take action to do something about it. So if you wanted to have your right thumb on top because you don't like the left thumb on top, if you did for the next month a couple times a day, kept practicing the other way, that would become your new habit, and it would become comfortable. Does that make sense? If it doesn't, do it for 30 and drop me a line. But the bottom line is, what it is that you might want, that you think macula took away. Sure, it did take away certain things, but let's look inside and find out what things we can do, who we can go out and now help those. This room should almost be filled with the amount of people that live here with people suffering. So bring this message of hope. Bring this message to them so they can have a better day. Thank you, guys.
In closing, we hope that this session will help reinvigorate that low vision group. We are more than happy to provide content and work together with you to spread the word not only about MVRF and the research and what we're doing, but also give you information to share with each other. I also want to mention, again, remind you that Chuck Cohen's in the back of the room if you want to look at some of the magnifiers and other products that he has, the things that Charlie spoke about that really transformed his life. You'd be surprised what's out there and doesn't have to cost a lot, okay? And I want to thank my team, Nikki and Lynn, who work really hard to put this together. Thank you, Joan Biddle, for volunteering and for others who helped us. And I hope that, as I said in the beginning, if you would go out there and tell everyone you know about us, spread the word, tell folks about what you learned today. I learned about 5 or 6 things, actually, that I didn't know before. So have a wonderful day. Have a cozy evening. I hear it's going to get warmer out there, so you have that to look forward to. And if you need anything at all, please let us know. There's information in your packets. There's a newsletter that's free, chock full of information. People love it. We have a great website. Call one of us anytime. We are here to help you. And I'm here to tell you that a cure is in sight. There are huge advancements going on, right, Dr. Brilliant? And this is curable. It may not be in your lifetime, we hope it is, but it's going to get there. So there's a lot going on in the field, and it's because we fund the research to get the work done to help all of you. So have a great day. Thank you very much, and take care.